Welcome.
Jai Jinendra, it gives me immense pleasure in welcoming you to this webinar amidst this lockdown on the recent amendment to in the Finance Bill 2020, which has been passed by the Lok Sabha on 23rd of March 2020. For that, we have a learned speaker, CA Pankaj Jain, who would be giving us the detail of the amendment in the Finance Bill 2020. And for prior to that, let me thank the hard work that has been put in by Hiral, Virag, Punit and Palak Parekh to make this webinar a successful one. And it has been always our endeavor of JCAF to update our members with professional amendments and whatever that is going through the professional issues. And for that, we have this webinar today. It has been, let me tell you, it has been due to the hard work that is all the JCAF team members have been putting in, and everyone is really concerned. But let me, prior to that, let me wish you all a happy Gudi Padwa, Cheti Chand and Navratri. But please, please, this is a request not only from me, but from everyone. Please stay at home, be safe, and let's all together conquer this coronavirus. Now, I would request Hiral to introduce our speaker, Pankaj Jain, CA Pankaj Jain. Thank you.
Welcome, everybody. Thank you for the opening remarks, President Sir. Unfortunately, we are not able to have the screen of President Shri Pradeep Kapadia. With the brief, with the task of introducing today's speaker, CA Pankaj Jain. CA Pankaj Jain cleared his CA in 2002. Since then, he has been in practice. Thereafter, he completed his DISA from the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India and LLB in 2010. He is the managing partner of SBP and Associates, having offices at Marine Lines and Nariman Point. His core area of practice is direct tax, and definitely he loves sharing of knowledge. His passion to share knowledge took him to the teaching profession, which he pursued for more than a decade, teaching intricacies in direct tax to students of PE2 and CA final. He shares knowledge at various forums regularly. He has recently co-authored a book on taxation of charitable trust published by our own JCAF. He is fond of Hindi music and likes to read autobiography in his free time. And sir, most of us are having free time. So happy learning to y'all. And JCAF is the pioneer to start this learning series, wherein we can sit at our own places and have the sharing of knowledge. Over to you, Pankaj bhai. Welcome, sir.
Thank you, Hiral bhai, for your kind words. Good evening, all of you, all our friends. Let me thank Hiral bhai and Virag bhai, Palak, for ensuring that this webinar is organized at a very, very short notice of less than 24 hours. So I would request all of you to bear with us if there are some lapses or if there are some technical default, because all of us, we are working from home. We are utilizing the available infrastructure, which is definitely not geared up to conduct webinars or professional seminars, but we have tried our level best, as also the material were not available because we are not in our office, though we have tried all our level best to ensure that we get all the correct and valid information which has been properly validated. If there are some lapses, I would be happy to be corrected upon, and please bear with us. So let's start our, and also the delay was because of the technical glitch which was happening due to work from home. So not wasting much time, let's start with the recent amendments which were proposed by the Honorable Finance Minister in the Lok Sabha on 22nd of March 2020. So this Finance Bill 2020 was presented in 1st February 2020 and was debated, discussed at length over various quarters, especially because of various path breaking amendments to this definition of residential status, taxation of dividends, TCS provision, charitable registrations, etc., etc. And because of this very, very path-breaking and very innovative amendments which were made, there were many anomalies, many practical difficulties, which were being observed by various stakeholders. And many representations were made, and the government has duly considered most of the representations, and have come out with almost 50 amendments, and it is a very exceptional thing to come out with like more than 50 amendments as an amendment bill at the time of passing of the bill. But yes, this is a fact this time. So what I have done here is I have captured some of the very, very important amendments for our discussion. So let's start with our presentation. The first and the most discussed, debated and studied provision was this provision of residential status. If you recollect, the original proposal in 2020 finance bill was that if a citizen of India or a person of Indian origin comes back to India on a visit, his stay was reduced from 182 days to 120 days. This was one major amendment wherein most of this non-resident citizen of India or person of Indian origin were disturbed because they used to normally stay in India up to 150 days, 160 days, or less than 182, 181 days. Suddenly, they have reduced that by almost 2 months. And this has created a great amount of resentment amongst the non-resident Indians and the people of person of Indian origin. Second important amendment which was made was a new concept of taxation based on citizenship, which is a very new concept for India. Basically, this concept is normally used in United States of America. So the government of India has also come out with this new concept of deemed residential status, which provides that if a citizen of India or if a citizen of India does not earn or does not pay taxes in any of the jurisdiction outside India and is earning income in India, then he will be deemed to be resident in India irrespective of his stay in India. Now, these two provision has created great amount of controversies. The government has also came out, or the finance ministry has also came out with the clarification, the circular, saying that we only want to tax people who are trying to dodge the taxation and not to the honest taxpayer who are genuinely working hard outside India and earning foreign currency for India. Nevertheless, this controversy was there. However, with these two amendments, there was one more amendment which was given by way of relief, by reducing the number of years from 9 years to 7 years for determination of resident but not ordinary resident. So earlier, if a person becomes resident for the first time, then for first 2 years, he will remain resident but not ordinary resident, because the condition was he should be resident in 9 years out of 10 years in the preceding financial years, preceding the year in which the residential status has to be determined. So this 9 year period was relaxed from 9 to 7 years, which means that for first 4 years, the person will remain resident but not ordinary resident. So there were two amendments which has reduced the flexibility of citizen of India coming to India. However, this new provision gave them a window of 4 years to remain or enjoy the status of resident but not ordinary resident. So these were the three original propositions which were made, or the proposal which were made in the original bill. So after all the discussion, debate, representation, everything, the government had decided to not disturb the existing provision, and they came out with a complete overhauling of this provision. So to put it in a simple word, what they have provided now is that if the total income of a citizen of India or a person of Indian origin, other than foreign income, which means the income which is accrued in India, received in India, earned in India, and income which is earned outside India from the business control or profession set up in India, these are the four categories of income. If this income together in a financial year is not more than 15 lakhs, then the new proposal or the new amendment suggests that the old provisions would apply, which means 182 days, no deemed residential status. Okay. However, so again, to just repeat, there is no change in law in respect of SSE whose total income excluding foreign income does not exceed 15 lakhs, which means if your client asks you a query as to, sir, what is my residential status or is there any change in residential status vis-a-vis the new amendment, so you have to just check whether his income during the year would be more than 15 lakhs Indian income or less than 15 lakhs. If it is less than 15 lakhs, the computation of residential status or determination of residential status will be as it was there in the earlier years. However, if the Indian income exceeds 15 lakhs, then these two amendments will kick in. What are the two amendments? So the number of days of stay in India, which was reduced from 182 days to 120 days, would trigger in, which means if Mr. A, who is a citizen of India and he comes to visit in India and stays in India for 130 days, his income is, say, 25 lakhs during the financial year, Indian income, I'm saying. Then, as per Section 6, Subsection 1, he will be, in Explanation 1, Clause B, he will be treated as resident in India. So even though his number of days stay in India is less than 182 days, but because his stay is more than 120 and his Indian income is more than 15 lakhs, he will be considered as resident in India. Similarly, if a citizen of India earns income more than 15 lakhs in India and he is not subject to taxation in any other country on account of his domicile or residence, he will be deemed, please mark my words, he will be deemed to be resident in India, which means that Mr. A stays in India only for 25 days during the financial year. He does not have, or his income in India is more than 15 lakhs and he is not paying any tax in any of the country because he is in Dubai or he is in Singapore, where the taxation on individuals are either negligible or are at very, very concessional rate. But in his case, he is not paying any taxation in any other jurisdiction. So in such case, even if his residence or stay in India is only 25 days, but because he is citizen of India and not paying any tax in any other jurisdiction, he will be deemed to be resident in India. So the amendments which was made originally will kick in only if the Indian income is more than 15 lakhs. Okay. However, they have given a very important protection net to such people who has become resident in India because of these two provision being kicked in. So there is an amendment to Section 6, subsection 6, which provides that if a person becomes resident and his stay is more than 120 days, but less than 182 days, which means category 1, because of this category, he becomes resident in India, he will be considered as resident but not ordinary resident by default. So his status will always be resident but not ordinary resident, meaning that his Indian income will be taxable, which in any case was taxable. His income from a business outside India, controlled from India, or a profession set up from India, this is the only additional income which is going to be taxed in the case of such residents. So this provision has done away with all the fears which most of these citizens of India or people, a person of Indian origin, were having regarding their foreign income being taxed in India. So the law, the amendment very clearly provides that if a stay in India is more than 120 days but less than 182 days, then that person will be considered as resident but not ordinary resident, which means the foreign income of such people will never ever be taxed in India. A. B. Such people will also not be required to report their foreign assets. That is very, very important. Such people will not be required to disclose their foreign asset under the income tax return. The second amendment which has been made under section 6 subsection 6 is that if a person becomes a resident because of the deeming provision which we just discussed, he is becoming resident because he is citizen of India and he is not paying tax in any other jurisdiction. So if a citizen of India becomes a deemed resident in India, the section very clearly provides in such cases he will be regarded, he will be considered as resident but not ordinarily resident, which means again in this case foreign income will not be subject to tax. So all the fear which people were having that our foreign income will be taxed, our hard-earned income which we are earning in the foreign countries would be taxed in India has been done away with, has been taken care by these two amendments. Now, one more important amendment which has been done is that the relaxation which was allowed from 9 years to 7 years, which is point number three in this screen, they have again removed that relaxation because now this relaxation is not required since they have diluted the original provision to a greater extent. So the relaxation of 7 years has now been removed, which means in all the other cases, other than these two cases, the residential and resident and not ordinary resident provision, the same provision which was there in the earlier year would apply. That is, he should be resident, non-resident for 9 years out of 10 years, and his stay in India should not exceed 765 days in 10 years. So these are the two important amendments which has been made. So just to recollect or just to recap the amendments which we have to consider now, which will become part of the Finance Act 2020, is that if the income is less than 15 lakhs, which is only Indian income, very important, then no new amendments are applicable. The old provisions are applicable. If it is more than 15 lakhs, yes, both the new provisions of 120 days or citizen of India not paying tax outside India, these both provision would apply. However, in these two categories, the SSE would always be treated as resident but not ordinary resident. And they have done away with the condition or amended condition which was of 7 years to the old provision of 9 years. So in my view, by making this amendment, they have completely diluted the provisions which were introduced to tax the citizens of India or people of Indian origin who are coming to India or who are doing business outside India and actually having all their base in India. So they have completely diluted by providing that they will be considered as resident and not ordinary resident. Please understand one important point. If suppose, let's take an example, I am citizen of India, I am not paying any tax in any other jurisdiction, and my income in India is more than 15 lakhs, I will be treated as resident but not ordinary resident for all the years, for all the coming years. So for 10 years, if I have that status, for 10 years, for 15 years, I will be treated as resident but not ordinary resident. Just to put it again in the right context, suppose if I stay in India between 120 days and 180 days or 181 days for another 10 years. So for all these 10 years, I will be treated as resident in India. I will be treated as resident in India, but I will always, always be considered as resident but not ordinary resident. However, if my stay exceeds 181 days, let's say my stay in India is 200 days, so I become resident, then for determination of resident but not ordinary resident, the original conditions of 765 days in 10 years and 9 years non-resident in 10 years would kick in. Then this exceptional or this new condition would not apply. So this new condition would apply only if I become resident by virtue of these two conditions which has been amended. So this is all about the residential status which they have diluted completely. I'm sure now none of the citizen of India or person of Indian origin will have any grievance or complaint in respect of these provisions.
Pankaj ji,
yes, sir.
Our member Mrinal Mehta ji had a query. Does this new residential provision apply to OCI, overseas citizen of India?
Yes, that's PIO is OCI. So it is applicable to OCI.
Okay.
So a small correction, there is a small error which has cropped in my presentation. Point number two, I have mentioned PIO. So this PIO clause is not applicable for this deeming provision. For deeming provision, it is only citizen of India. I'm sorry for the error, but yes, it is only and only for citizen of India that deemed residential status is applicable.
Sorry to interrupt for a minute. Members can post in their questions if at all there are any questions in the panel which is provided to you, and as and when would be there, the speaker would guide you accordingly. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. There were a series of amendments, if you recollect, under Section 1023C and Section 11, Trust, wherein they have reset the whole registration process by making it mandatory for all the trust to register afresh with effect from 1st June 2020 within 90 days. And this will be the fresh registration under the new section, Section 12AB, or under Section 1023C. So now what they have done, in the past, the registration was there under 12AA, and the SSC was having an option of claiming exemption either under Section 1023C in respect of hospital, medical institutions, universities, college, educational institutions. So now they have done away with that, and they have segregated these two clauses, and they have provided very categorically that either you can be under 1023C or you can be under Section 11. And to provide for that, they have made an amendment wherein they have asked all these trusts to register themselves either under 12AB or under Section 1023C, which all of us are aware and which we are going to start the procedural work post June 2020. Now, because these changes have been made and this 1023 trust has been segregated from 12AB, that is Section 11 provision, so there were some consequential amendments which were required, which were missed out in the original bill. So now they have provided that if a donation is given to a trust which is registered under Section 1023C with the direction that such donation should form part of the corpus, then such voluntary contribution or voluntary donation will not be treated as part of the income of such trust registered under 1023C. Now, this is exactly in line with Section 11. This is an existing provision or existing provision available under Section 11 as well. So they have, just to bring it at par, they have provided here as well that any contribution with the direction that it should form part of corpus would not be treated as part of the income. They have also made one corresponding exemption amendment. If you recollect the provision, it says that if there is an accumulation of income, if I'm not able to spend 85%, I'm talking of Section 11, if I'm not able to spend 85% of my income, then I am allowed to set aside or carry forward the income or the balance amount for 1 year or for 5 years, depending upon my purpose. Irrespective of whether it is 1 year or 5 years, there is a restriction which provides that I cannot make a donation out of this. Okay. As also, there is one more provision which has been introduced recently, which provides that if a trust registered under Section 12AA, now 12AB, makes a donation to another trust towards the corpus, then such donation will also not qualify as an application. For example, suppose Trust A, registered under 12AA, makes a donation to another trust, Trust B, which is also registered under 12AA, with the direction that it should form part of the corpus of trust. So the existing provision says that this contribution or this donation would not qualify as application, which means if my income is, say, 25 lakhs, out of which I have spent 23 lakhs by way of donation to another trust towards corpus, then as per the existing provision, it provides that this 23 lakhs which you have donated towards the corpus will not qualify as application, which means it will be treated as my income. Now they have extended this to the trust registered under 1023C as well. So it's only a consequential amendments. Because they have segregated 1023C trust and 12 section 11 trust separately, so they have also introduced this one more provision in the explanation, wherein they have now provided that any payment to any trust registered under 12AB or 1023C would not be allowed as application if it is contributed towards the corpus of such trust. So this is just a consequential amendment which has been made. And then existing amendment was there, or sorry, existing provision was there. It has been extended to section 1023C trust as well. Now coming to one of the most discussed, debated, argued amendments regarding dividend. So till last year, the taxation of dividend was a new concept which was introduced somewhere in 1997, then reintroduced in 2003, wherein a company was liable to pay dividend distribution tax on distribution of dividend, and the recipient was eligible to claim exemption under section 1034 or 1035. So there was a representation from the foreign investors from many years that because of this dividend distribution tax being paid by the company at source at a time of distributing dividend, we are not able to claim tax credit of that tax. So if you tax it in our hands in India, we will be eligible to claim tax credit in our country under double taxation avoidance agreement, and therefore it will become a more cost effective investment for us, or our returns will improve. So considering this representation, the amendment was made. The amendment was made in this year, wherein the taxation of dividend has now been taken back to the classical system, wherein the company pays the dividend, it is received by the individual or the shareholders, and the tax is being paid by the shareholder at their respective applicable rates. So to bring into effect these changes, various amendments had been made to various sections like 1034, 115O, 194K, so many amendments have been made to ensure that these amendments are taken effect. So one of the amendments which was made in 1034 regarding exemption was, there was a proviso which was introduced to 1034 saying that if any dividend is received on or after 1st April 2020, such dividend would not be exempt from tax. Obviously, because dividend distribution tax is not applicable on or after 1st April 2020. So consequentially, they made a provision in 1034 or made provided under 1034 to say that this exemption would not be available. However, there an anomaly remained in that, because it is possible. Now it is not possible because of the coronavirus, but practically it is possible that a company declares, distributes dividend, say on 25th March, it pays dividend distribution tax, because as on 25th March 2020, dividend distribution tax is applicable. By the time company process the refunds and everything, and the shareholder receives the dividend, it is a 2nd April. Now, if you read the provision, it says that any dividend received on or after 1st April 2020, it would not qualify for exemption, meaning the company had paid dividend distribution tax, the shareholder will have to pay dividend tax again, or tax on the dividend income again. So to do away with this anomaly, they amended this proviso in this amendment bill, and they have provided that if in respect of any dividend which is received on or after 1st April 2020, the company has paid dividend distribution tax, then this proviso would not apply. Meaning that I will be eligible to claim this exemption. However, very important, I will be liable to pay tax at a rate of 10% under section 115BDA, which is, if my dividend income is more than 10 lakhs, then I would be liable to pay dividend tax on that income if it exceeds 10 lakhs. So this amendment has been made to remove this anomaly of double taxation. So now they have the provision provides that this exemption would be available provided that the dividend distribution tax is paid by the company and the recipient is also subject to 115 BBDA. So in the series of amendment to dividend, there was one more very important section which was introduced, section 80M. This is exactly in line with the section which was there under 115O also, to avoid double taxation of dividend income. So let's take an example. If a company pays a dividend to another company and that another company pays dividend to its shareholder. Now, if you apply the normal principle of taxation, so 100 rupees distributed by the company, A company to B company, the B company pays tax on that 100. Then that 100 is distributed by B company to C shareholder. So again, C shareholder pays tax. Now the company in the middle is only a pass-through kind of entity because the dividend income has been again redistributed. So earlier also there was a provision wherein this relief was allowed in computation of dividend distribution tax. On the same line, this ATM is also introduced by way of a deduction under Chapter 6A. So it was introduced, of course, it was introduced in the original Finance Bill 2020. However, they have expanded the scope of this ATM from dividend from domestic company, and they have now included dividend received from foreign company and dividend received from business trust. Now, this is very important. Even now, a foreign company, if I receive a dividend from a foreign company, even that contribution or that dividend would qualify for the purpose of deduction under Section 80M. So this is a welcome move. This is a relief which the corporate sector will get on account of this amendment. So the existing amendment provision has been kept as it is, and they have just added two new source of dividend to qualify as dividend for the purpose of computing deduction under ATM. However, if the company offers income from dividend from foreign company at a concessional rate of 10% under Section 115 BBD. If you recollect, that provision talks about dividend received from a subsidiary company outside India. So that such dividend would qualify for taxation at a concessional rate of 10%. So the provision 115 BBD also provides that once you opt for this section, no deduction under any other provisions of the Act would be eligible or would be available. So in view of that restriction posed under that 115 BBD, ATM would not be available in respect of such dividend from foreign company which is subject to tax under 115 BBD. However, this ATM, though it's a beneficial provision, but it will really not benefit a company if the gross total income of the company is negative or has been absorbed on account of some carried forward unabsorbed depreciation or losses or additional depreciation or etc. etc. So to that extent, definitely there would be a double taxation because that income will be taxed in the hands of company and dividend would again be taxed in the hands of the shareholder. So, and it can, the multiple companies can claim this benefit. If A company has given dividend to B company, B company has given to C, C has given to D. So all this company in this whole process would qualify to claim deduction under Section 80M. So this ATM provision is basically to avoid double taxation. Amendment is concerning expanding the scope of the dividend income from domestic company to foreign company dividend and to dividend received from business trust. So the next consequential amendment is the TDS on dividend income. So if you all recollect, there were two provisions which were introduced for TDS on dividend. One was then existing provision 194, TDS on dividend from domestic company, and another TDS provision introduced was in respect of dividend distributed by mutual fund company which are registered or recognized under Section 1023D. Now there was the plain reading of the original 194K introduced by Finance Act 2020 was giving an impression that any income distributed, any income distributed by a mutual fund company or mutual fund concern unit to its unit holder would be subject to TDS under 194K, which means that if I redeem, say, my mutual fund for 50 lakhs, I would be subject to 5% TDS. That was the interpretation which was coming out on account of the interpretation of the language of the existing provision. So to do away with that confusion to controversy, they have specifically provided a list of exclusion. And one of the list of item in that exclusion is that if the payment is in the nature of income, or income is in the nature of capital gains, then the provision of 194K would not apply. So this amendment has done away with the fear which the market or the stakeholders were having concerning TDS provision being invoked in respect of redemption amount. So now they have made it very clear that this provision would not apply in respect of income in the nature of capital gains. So again, this is a kind of clarificatory amendment. So these are the three amendments concerning dividend income. So if there are no queries from the audience, we can proceed with the next slide. So equalization levy. Now, if you see the amendment bill which has been introduced, there is an amendment which is further proposed to Finance Act 2016, Section 65, 66, 67, and so on. So this provision was concerning equalization levy. This equalization levy was introduced by Finance Act 2016. It was originally introduced to tax the advertisement revenue on an online platform like Facebook, Twitter, all these companies who don't have servers in India and they are earning huge revenue, Google, who are earning huge revenue from online advertisement from India, were not paying any tax because they were not domiciled in India, they were not having any PE in India, etc., etc., etc. So to do away with that, the government came out in 2016, they came out with this tax of equalization levy, that whenever there is a payment made by a person in India for advertisement released on an online platform to a non-resident, it will be subject to equalization levy. And there was a consequential amendment made in that year to Section 10, subsection 50, wherein such income earned by non-resident would be exempt from tax, obviously, because the tax has already been collected by way of an equalization levy. This amendment bill now proposed to expand the scope of this equalization levy to e-commerce operators. So the amendment bill have proposed now to include the payments made to non-resident e-commerce operator under the ambit of equalization levy. With effect from 1st April 2020, the equalization levy will be chargeable at 2% from the consideration received or receivable by a non-resident e-commerce operator from an e-commerce supply of goods or services. So it is goods or services, both are included. So who are the supplier? Facilities by it to the following. So who are the recipient of the service? A person who is resident of India, if he is receiving any services from an e-commerce operator, he is liable, or this transaction is covered. A person who buys such goods or services, or both, using internet protocol address located in India. Or a non-resident person in the following circumstances: sale of advertisement which targets a customer who is registered in India, or a customer who accesses the advertisement through internet protocol address located in India. So India targeted advertisement which are been used or which were been run by the non-resident operator or a non-resident service user would also be covered. All these transactions would also be covered. Now, one very important thing which you should note here is, in this case, the equalization levy is on a reverse basis. In the normal cases, the person who makes the payment a person who makes the payment is liable to deposit equalization levy. It's like a TDS. This provision is exactly like TCS. So the person who is resident in India and using services of e-commerce operator, suppose I order from Amazon Inc., Amazon USA, some product. So I'm a person who is resident in India. I'm buying such goods. So this transaction is covered under equalization levy. Now, I am not liable to deduct tax or deposit equalization levy. The law provides that in such cases, it is the e-commerce operator who would be liable to deposit 2% of that consideration, 2% of that value as equalization levy, with the government of India. Now, this is exactly like TCS. So the original provision, which was regarding online transaction, online advertisement, was like TDS, wherein the person who is making the payment was liable to deposit the tax. This is exactly like TCS, wherein the person who is receiving the money is liable to deposit 2% equalization levy. However, there is a threshold limit. If such e-commerce operator is carrying on the activity in India and his total turnover from the complete activity in India is not more than 2 crore, then he is not subject to this provision. But if his turnover is more than 2 crore rupees, then yes, this equalization levy would be applicable to such e-commerce operator. So this obligation, as we have discussed, section 166A is a new provision which has been introduced under Finance Act 2016, shifts the obligation to deposit the equalization levy on the e-commerce operator. This obligation is of e-commerce operator only, which means if your client has done any transaction with a non-resident e-commerce operator, our client did not worry, we need not worry about any compliance and the equalization levy, because this is an obligation which has been casted upon the e-commerce operator. So, however, they have provided that if the e-commerce operator has a permanent establishment in India, then such e-commerce operator would not be subject to equalization levy, because obviously their income earned in India or attributable to transaction in India is taxable in India because they have a permanent establishment. So also the due dates for these e-commerce operators have been given differently because they are non-resident, not in India. So they are not under the obligation to deposit this equalization levy on a monthly basis, as it is the case on online advertisement. In our regular cases, we have to collect equalization levy and deposit within by 7th of the next month, as exactly we are doing for TDS. However, in this case, because they are non-resident, they are not based in India, they have provided them window of 3 months. So the period is April to June. They have to deposit by 7 July, 7th October, 7th January. However, for the last quarter, they have to deposit equalization levy on the same day as 31st March. The consequential exemption has been provided, as I have just mentioned, for online advertisement. Even this e-commerce operator, the moment they deposit this 2%, their income is fully exempt from tax. Their income is fully exempt from tax under section 10, subsection 50 of the Act. Yeah. However, if you read the bare text of the bill, there seems to be a typographical error. It provides that this exemption is available only in respect of goods or services supplied on or after 1st April 2021. It provides that this exemption is available only in respect of goods or services supplied on or after 2021, whereas the equalization levy is applicable from 1st April 2020. So definitely it is a typographical error, which the rectification will come up soon. But yes, there's some printing error which has remained, maybe because of the last minute pressure on the government because of the coronavirus, and they had to wrap up the session because of this disease, and they wanted to pass this bill before 31st March. So because of this, it's possible that there may be some error, and this is the error which probably would be highlighted and pointed and would be rectified. one of the most debated provision 115 BAC, wherein an individual was given an option of going for concessional rate, no exemption, or the regular rate with exemption.
So, Pankaj ji.
Yeah.
Piyush Chajed ji had a question. How will administratively levy collected from non-residents?
So they will be under obligation. Under the law, they are under obligation to deduct or to collect the tax. So they will have to comply if they are, they have to do business in India. They will have to comply with the local laws of India. So they will have to register. They will appoint some professionals in India. So it's an opportunity for professionals to get this work, and they will have to comply with it. So administratively, they will have to. So it, it will exactly be like your TDS, TCS. They will be able to pay the tax, deposit the equalization levy in the due date. They will be liable to file the returns. There, there will be assessments happening. There may be demand raised. So this is the whole process that they will have to go through. Hello. 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 Can I proceed?
Yes, sir. Please.
Yeah.
Sir, there was one more question from a participant, Mr. Pradeep Shah. I think e-commerce have to register for GST also.
Yes. Yes. So there are e-commerce, and also there are provisions concerning under section 194, wherein there are some TDS provision applicable. So e-commerce have to, and in any case, when they're doing business in India, they have to take permissions from RBI. They can't just do business in India. So they have to, in any case, comply with lot many provisions. So this would be one of the additional provisions which they will comply.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Can I proceed?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir, please.
So this is one of the most debated and discussed provision. There was a small, I would say, a typo error or mention to be remained under subsection 5, the conditions to be fulfilled to claim this exemption or to claim this section, only business was referred to in that subsection 5. So they have just amended and they have included the word profession as well in that section. So that now not only people who are carrying on the business activity, but also the people who are into profession would be eligible to claim this exemption. So if I just read subsection 5, original subsection 5, it provided nothing contained in this section shall apply unless option is exercised in the prescribed manner by the person. Now, originally it was only having business income. So now they realize that it, we can, the, with this provision, the provision is available only to people having business income, which was not the intention. So they have amended it and they have included the word profession as well into this. So now it reads that having business or profession income. So everything remains the same. They have only included the word profession to bring in at par with business. So some TDS changes in the TDS provision at a glance. Section 194J, fees for technical services was one of the amendment which was made, wherein the TDS rate prescribed what as 2%. The reason was that there was a very silver lining difference between a contractual payment and payment for technical services. So always there is to be a dispute whether it is a technical service or whether it is a contractual service. And to do away with that controversy, to do away with the controversy, they have provided that even in respect of fees for technical services, the TDS rate will be 2%. So they have expanded. They have expanded the scope. They have expanded the scope of this concessional TDS rate to royalty income, which is in the nature of consideration for sale, distribution, or exhibition of cinematographic films. Very important. It's only cinematographic films. If it is. I think we have exceeded the time, so I had to, you need to do it okay to continue. Hello.
I think participants would be okay with it, so I think we should continue. And
there's more, 3 slides more which we need to cover. That's all.
Please, sir, continue. Yeah, please, sir.
So they have extended this. They have extended this concessional rate of TDS under 194J to royalty income in the nature of consideration for sale, distribution, or exhibition of cinematographic film. It's only for cinematographic films, not for any advertisement or some jingle or some music, etc. It is only for cinematographic film that they have reduced 10% TDS rate to 2%. One important amendment which has been made to 194N, it's an existing provision wherein the TDS on cash withdrawal was provided. If the withdrawal is more than 1 crore from a cooperative bank or from a regular bank, the provision provided that it provided that a TDS of 2% has to be deducted by the banks if there is a withdrawal in excess of 1 crore. So this year, now in this proposal, they have made a further amendment. Now this is a little complicated amendment vis-a-vis the deductor. So it provides that the threshold limit of 100 lakhs will reduce to 20 lakhs in case where the person withdrawing the cash has not filed his return within the time prescribed in the 139(1), which is the due date, during the 3 years preceding the relevant previous year. Now this is an additional job for the banks. For all the people who are withdrawing above 20 lakhs, the banks will have to ask them that please provide your ITR copy for last 3 years. Then they have to do an analysis whether all these three returns are filed in time. So the due date of some cases may be 31st July, some cases it may be 30th September, some cases it may be 30th November. So this is an additional administrative work which the bank will have to undertake. In wherever there is a cash withdrawal above 20 lakhs, they will have to ask for this information, and accordingly they will have to take a call. If the returns are not filed or not filed in time in all 3 years, then this amended provision would trigger in. Now what is the provision? Up to 20 lakhs TDS rate is nil. Above 20 lakh, up to 1 crore TDS rate is 2%, and withdrawal above 1 crore TDS rate will be 5%. So this is only an additional I would say the expansion in the scope. So the original provision was above 1 crore 5%. Amended provision, if it is above 20 lakhs and the person who is withdrawing the money has not filed his return in time, very important, sir, in time. It is not return filed. It is to be filed in time in all the 3 years. If there is a default in all the 3 years, then yes, you are subject to this new TDS provision wherein the rate will be 2% up to 1 crore and above 1 crore it will be 5%. So again, e-commerce participant, this was a new provision which was introduced under 194O for TDS in respect of payment made to e-commerce operator. So the definition of e-commerce operator, they have just amended. The only change which they have made is the words which I have striked out have been deleted. So the original was e-commerce operator means a person who owns, operate, or manage digital or electronic facility or platform for electronic commerce. And there was an additional condition. So there were two conditions, and is responsible for paying to e-commerce participant. So to do away with the case where he is not responsible because the operator or the e-commerce participant is directly receiving the money and he pays the commission, in such cases this condition will not be fulfilled. So to do away with such scenario, they have deleted this word, this condition of "and is responsible". So now the provision would apply whether the e-commerce operator receives the money or the e-commerce participant receives the money. The TDS provision of under section 194O would apply in all the cases. So the last but not the least, one of the most discussed, debated and stressed about provision was TCS under section 206C. So there were two subsection which were newly introduced by the original finance bill 2020. One was 206C clause 1G, subsection 1G, and another was 1H. So 1G was in respect of, which was considering, or which was in respect of two categories. Category 1 was payment under LRS to an authorized dealer above 7 lakhs. And another was for a tour package, or payment to a tour operator for a tour package outside India. Under subsection 1H, it was sale of goods above 50 lakhs was subject to TCS. So it was to be kicked in from 1st April 2020. And nobody was aware, and there were so many queries. The systems were not geared up, because this all requires alteration at the software level to capture all this, because this is a routine process which has to be captured by the software. So normally the TDS, CCS provisions are normally effective from 1st June or 1st July, so as to give time to the companies to gear up their software. However, they have considered this coronavirus, and instead of 1st June, now they have made it applicable from 1st October 2020, which means both these new provisions which were introduced, both these provisions would be applicable from 1st October 2020. Now, the threshold limit of 7 lakhs is not applicable. Now, if the payment is made under LRS for purchase of overseas tour package, this is very important. So for overseas tour or for tour package, if I'm making payment outside India under the normal provision of which was proposed, there was no basic exemption limit from TCS. Every rupee you pay to your tour operator for foreign tour was subject to TCS. So there was a window available that instead of paying to the tour operator, under LRS I pay directly to hotels outside or to tour operator outside India and bypass this 5%. So they have plugged out this loophole, and they've said that if you're making payment for purchase of a tour package, overseas tour package, then in such cases, the threshold limit of 7 lakhs would not be available. TCS rate would be 5%, which is same. They have given one more relief. If I have taken a loan, educational loan in India, which qualifies for deduction under ATE, and that amount is remitted outside India for payment of the fee, then in such case, the TCS would be at 0.5%. Instead of 5%, it will be 0.5% in excess of rupees 7 lakhs. So this is a welcome amendment that if my son is studying abroad and I have borrowed money from the bank for his education, so such payment, if done under LRS, would attract 0.5% TCS. And in all other cases, payment in excess of 7 lakhs would attract TCS at 5%. So in the original proposal, there was a confusion that the moment you exceed 7 lakhs, whether full amount would be subject to TCS or only the amount exceeding 7 lakhs would be subject to TCS. So this was the confusion which was there. Now they have removed that confusion by providing various provisos. So now it is very clear that if the payment exceeds 7 lakhs, then only the TCS is kicked in. A, B, the TCS is applicable only for the amount exceeding 7 lakhs. And two most important amendments which everybody was asking this query, that TCS on sale of goods, whether it would apply to export of goods, sale, export sale and import of goods. So this has been answered, and they have provided that if there is an export of goods, TCS is not applicable. If there's import of goods, TCS is not applicable. So they have addressed almost all the major concerns which the stakeholders had with various amendments which were made very properly, and they have made all the amendments which has taken care of it. So these are all the important amendments which I had to discuss with you all today. So we can proceed with the queries, if any. Yes.
Sir, there was a query. One second. From Mr. Jay Kumar Shah, but I think he has already left. His query was, I'll just read it out. I'm not able to make out exactly. 15 lakh income is taxable income only, or if the income is tax-free, like dividend, long-term capital gains, etc. For example, will it make any difference if the person has LTCG of say 50 lakhs and has invested in bonds and no taxable income?
So it will be, because it's a total income. So when we are referring to total income, it should be taxable income. The income will form part of total income only if it is taxable. So to answer the query, if I have an exempt income less than 15 lakhs, I'm not subject to this provision.
Fine, sir. I think I don't have any other queries. Still, we'll give a couple of minutes for participants if they have any queries. Pradeep Bhai Shah has a query. There are issues with TDS in respect of sale of goods with respect to payments above 50 lakhs. How to calculate and collect?
So the incidence of collection is on receipt basis. Now this is something very tricky thing which we'll have to gear up in the software itself. So most of the people are saying that at the time of raising the bill, we will add that 1%. So that there is no confusion. But yes, this is a practical challenge which everybody is facing as to how to do that. So it has to be geared up with the software, and either you trigger it at a time of receipt. So every time you record a receipt, your system will trigger this 1% TCS and it will account for it. Or if you want to play safe and very very easy.
Fine, sir. Sir, then query from Sejal Shyam. Transfer from NRE to NRO account above rupees 7 lakhs. Is TCS applicable? The transfer from NRE to NRO account above rupees 7 lakhs. Is TCS applicable?
Hello, am I audible?
Yes, Pankaj ji.
So I was saying that yes, that is the reason the law has also provided that the liability to pay TCS arises at the time of receipt. So every time you receive the money, you have to identify complete 1% and provide the liability for TCS as we do for TDS.
Okay, I think there is some connectivity issue. Just participants could hold on for a minute or so.
Use only the internet.
Pankaj ji. Pankaj ji, are you able to hear me?
I am able to hear you, but I don't know whether the audience are connected still.
They are connected. We have another query that transfer from NRE to NRO account above rupees 7 lakhs. Is TCS applicable?
No, because it is transfer from your own account to your own account. It is not a remittance. In the sense, it is a remittance from Pemba perspective. It is shifting of money from your account to your own account. So TCS provision would not apply.
Sir, then we have this, the time limit for cash withdrawals is for financial year 21 starting July 20. Hardik Mehta has this question.
Okay.
The limit for cash withdrawals is for financial year 21 starting July 20.
Now they are talking about aggregate, which means post June they will compute for the whole year. Though it is effective, but it's an aggregate of the withdrawal.
Fine, sir. Kaushik Bhai Gada has a query. In case of default of return for 1 year and the other year in time, what will that provision old, apply?
Old provision would apply. Not the amended provision would not apply. 1 crore limit would apply.
Okay. Mrinal Bhai has a query. For OCI, the residential status will be determined on the basis of 182 days or 120 days.
For OCI visiting India, 120 days would be the, if their income is less than 15 lakhs, then 182 days. If their income is more than 15 lakhs, 120 days.
Our own Jayesh Bhai has a query. Jayesh Bhai Kalam. Is there any minimum threshold limit for applicability of equalization levy?
Under the new provision?
Yes.
Under the new provision. 2 crores turnover. Sorry, equalization levy, no threshold limit.
Jay Kumar Shah has a query. Whether TDS applicable for amount transferred from FD withdrawals to NRI to NRE account? Whether TDS applicable for amount transferred?
From
NRI to NRE account.
It's a transfer of money from same pocket, one pocket to another pocket of the same person. So there is no element of income involved. So section 195 is not applicable, TDS is not applicable.
Okay. Akshay has a query. And we take this last query and then I would request our General Secretary of JCAF, Amrit Bhai, to offer a vote of thanks. Is there any clarification with respect to the audit limit of 5 crores of cash receipts, where 5% of cash receipts of total receipts and 5% of cash payments of total payments is to be considered? Any clarification as to what is considered as total receipts and total payments, and what are the receipts and payments which are not to be considered?
So, to my mind and to my knowledge, I have not come up with any clarification. But if I have to do that, I would look at the P&L account, so receipt of P&L account and payment from P&L account. I would not consider any payment on capital expenditure or capital side. So I will take P&L as a base to decide whether 5% limit is achieved or not. Hello.
Fine, sir. I would request our General Secretary, Shri Amrit Bhai Porwal, to please carry, take it ahead. Yes, Amrit Bhai.
Yeah. Jai Jinendra. Am I audible?
Amrit Ji,
yes.
Yes,
very much. Yeah.
You can hear me, sir. No, Jai Jinendra.
Yeah.
Friends, first of all, I would like to extend my greetings on the occasion of Gudi Padwa to all the participants. Friends, it was a maiden attempt on behalf of JCAF to hold this webinar, first time in the history of JCAF, and with participation of all of you, we have made it a great success. There are more than 60 participants who have joined this webinar, and we would like to first thank you all for taking part in this first of the webinar by JCAF. We are also thankful to CA Pankaj Jain for willing to or having made it possible by allowing us and giving his time at a very short notice to present this presentation on analysis and discussion on finance bill passed in Lok Sabha at a very short notice of just one day. Friends, we are also thankful to Mr. Hiral, Ms. Palak and Virag Bhai for heading this technical team and making this webinar possible. With this, we all request you to applaud Mr. Pankaj Jain for this maiden effort on webinar. Friends,
thank you. Stay safe
in this corona. Be safe and secure. Thanks a lot.
Stay home, stay safe. All the best. Thank you so much. Thank you for the patient hearing.
All the best, everyone. Thank you.